Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents. You have a book in you. Make money with your story. By Mark Victor Hansen. Narrated by Jared Zak.
Preface. Be ye inspired to write. You're reading this right now because you have an awareness inside that there is a book in you that needs to come out. Perhaps you have many books to share with the world. Writing is a deeply and profoundly inspirational experience for the writer, and ultimately for the readers. Books have the ability to inspire in many dimensions, and book writing can create excellence in thought, giving you an ever higher experience of life and living. Your future is created by being passionately on purpose about something. Your purpose of being alive is to create and contribute. Writing is inspired creation at its best, and when done in the spirit of excellence, leaves a great and lasting contribution. Within you now is the ability to write things you never dreamed possible, and to serve greatly with love. Writing your book will be an unforgettable learning experience. Writing is a wonderful way to help you become all that you can be. Only you have the ability to write your book. Contained herein is perhaps the magic elixir to stimulate you to do it. Everyone is capable of expressing their unique experiences and understanding through the art of writing. I suspect you have special dreams, understandings, and visions you need to share, or you wouldn't have chosen this book. When you share the wisdom you have locked deep inside of you, you have the potential to change the world. Maybe someone has told you, you ought to write a book. Or you've thought it yourself. I know that this idea is worthy of becoming a book, and I'm the one to do it. That is the perfect place from which your ideas and your talents start to bloom. As you take the first step, and your ability to write and clearly express your thinking grows and develops, you'll be energized to keep going. A feeling of awe and wonder will come as you put your ideas and thoughts into form and see them begin to come to life. A bicycle can only balance if it is moving forward. You, as a writer, have to keep writing to balance and continue moving ahead on your writing journey. Connect with your potential fans early. Ask for feedback from friends, and get support from the beginning. As your writing grows, you will start to create your own fan base. Your fans will potentially last far into the future, so remember to keep talking to them, and also to keep a database. I am forever reading The Brilliance of the Ages, written hundreds and thousands of years ago, the works of Plato, Mark Twain, Shakespeare, the Apostle Paul, and the stories of leaders like Alexander the Great or Genghis Khan. All departed from physical form long ago, but have left us their wisdom contained in the pages of books. As you move through the writing journey and your book starts to get read, you'll realize that you have the power to influence through your writing. Maybe you'll find opportunities to speak on stages to further illuminate your readers and fans. Eventually, your book could grow into an enterprise of writing and giving speeches and seminars. From there, even more opportunities can blossom, such as offers to speak at universities. I have been given 10 honorary doctorates from different universities, which has been a delightful way to leverage my platform and share my message. Best of all, through your book, you are leaving a printed legacy that will last for all time. Your descendants, into many generations, will revel in reading their ancestors' work. That's an inspirational legacy worth leaving. Writing offers more opportunity now than ever in history. Of the 7.8 billion people living on planet Earth, approximately 4 billion are literate. My goal is to get everyone to be able to read, write, communicate, and think cooperatively into ever better tomorrows. Books connect minds that are far flung in place and time. bringing new understandings and illumination, and potentially fame and fortune, to the author. For the first time, I am sharing with you my insider story. I hope it inspires you to release your potential for writing greatness. The writer's challenges and opportunities have never been greater. So roll up your sleeves and get ready to enter the exciting world of authorship. Writing is an exciting and inviting journey. It can make you better, smarter, and wiser. With marketing prowess, it can also make you vastly richer. Writing books has given me a lifetime of wonderful experiences. I hope it does the same for you. Happy writing! Author's note. I hope and believe the book you're about to read will be much more than words printed on a page. I want this book to be part of an organic process that will encompass many great books by many thousands of authors. For that to happen, the information in this book will need to continually change and improve based on information from you, the readers and writers. What worked for you in these pages? What didn't work? What would you add or take out? Please let me know your thoughts at my website, reception@markvictorhansen.com, or by dropping me a note at this address. Mark Victor Hansen, P.O. Box 27618, Scottsdale, Arizona, 85255. Additionally, I want you to give me your email address so I can keep you up to date on new information, seminars, podcasts, my writings, other great works that you or my students write, and marketing breakthroughs that will help you make your enterprise grow easily, with less effort, and potentially more profitably. Books are the wealth of the world. Writing them can make you rich. You get paid for the quality and quantity of your writing and book marketing abilities. Books are fun at every level, for me, and I hope for you. It is easier to work at something you totally enjoy. Writing is definitely my right livelihood, and perhaps yours too. Authorship gives you pride, respect, and the appreciation of adoring readers. It also brings credibility and authority. Books are extraordinary door openers. They can improve your life and lifestyle. Books can be written by you alone or with a co-author, or they can be ghostwritten by someone else. Books are needed on absolutely every subject. They can be researched fairly easily and can be created inexpensively with paper and pen or on a computer. Books can be self-published or distributed through a publishing house. Book publishing, and profit, is as easy as uploading your report, article, chapter, paper, or full manuscript online on your website. You pick the price, and sales commence immediately. Book distribution has become available to everyone with the acquisition of an ISBN number. Books have made fortunes for many. J.K. Rowling, author of the Harry Potter books, is the richest woman in Britain thanks to her writing. Books can enable you to work as a reporter or journalist. For his classic work, Think and Grow Rich, Napoleon Hill interviewed the 500 most important men and women of his era. He sold 100 million books, made himself a fortune, and helped our country climb out of the Great Depression. Before that, Wallace Wattles helped readers emerge from the Depression of the 1890s with his classic book, The Science of Getting Rich. Books have immense potential impacts. That's why I encourage you to write and keep on writing. Books are your sacred creations, your babies. Creating a book helps you to grow, develop, manifest your fullest potential, and fulfill your destiny. When you look at obituaries, after a person's name and age, comes the books they wrote before any other listings. Books make the world work. They change your world and your reader's world. Books last forever. They leave a lasting legacy. Books enable you to serve greatly with love. They are also fun to create. Books are like exercise. Long after you're done, you still glisten from the effort. Books travel around the world and invite you along for the ride. Books help people conquer their fears, be excited about life and living, solve their problems, and improve their circumstances. Books are inclusive. They exclude no one. Everyone is better off, and no one is left out. Entrepreneur Jim Rohn said, "If you can read and don't, you are no better off than someone who cannot read." Recently, Dr. Peter Diamandis's X Prize was just won in Tanzania, where children in 40 villages learned to read their native language and English in 1.5 years, forever changing and improving their lives. Dr. Diamandis, Elon Musk, founder and funder of this X Prize, and I believe that in this decade, 4 billion non-readers will gain the advantage of learning to read, write, and communicate effectively. That could more than double the amount of books sold. Books can become businesses that create empires. Dale Carnegie's best-selling book, How to Win Friends and Influence People, created a worldwide training empire that grosses over $50 million each year. Books will introduce you to the most wonderful, helpful, insightful, wise, and leading-edge people in the world. Books impact lives profitably and permanently. They are a path from one head and heart to another. They connect us all. Books are your way to a potential fortune. Book authorship is a magnificent endeavor. Books are a force multiplier as your messages expand outward into the world. Books stimulate your thinking and the thinking of your readers. They change feelings and consciousness and create new futures and possibilities. Books advance the cause of freedom. Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin inspired President Abraham Lincoln to become the visionary leader of emancipation. In 1862, President Lincoln issued the Emancipation Proclamation, which is still expanding freedom for ever more people here and around the world. The best book of all time hasn't yet been written, so you have to write it. Introduction. This is the business we have chosen. The Godfather, Part 2. That's a famous line from one of the most powerful movies ever made. The script for that film was written by Mario Puzo, who also, of course, wrote the script for the first Godfather film, as well as the novel on which it's based. Mario Puzo had a lot of great things to say about writing, so we'll be referring to him and other writers throughout this book. But here at the start, I want to focus on one specific word in that quote above. The word is business. When you start to write a book, you're doing more than just punching keys on your keyboard. You're entering the book business, and like every other business, it has many different elements. I want you to be 100% successful in dealing with all those elements. Sigmund Freud said that people write books for three reasons: fame, love, and money. So let's make it happen. But first, let me repeat, you're not just writing a book. You're starting a commercial enterprise, which includes marketing, finances, and all the other facets of a profit-making enterprise. The book business requires time and effort, and above all, information. Without information, you can finish a manuscript, but you may also be the only person who ever reads it. I am here to make sure you have all the tools you need to not let that happen. One more thing. Maybe part of you thinks there's an easier way to achieve those three enticing goals of fame, money, and love. For example, you may be wondering why you can't just start a podcast or a blog and update it every couple of days. As we'll discuss, you can, and should, start a podcast or blog. But the foundation of your business must be your book. Your book will validate you as a real writer, not just in your reader's mind, but in your own mind, too. A book shows you're serious. You've paid the price and jumped through all the hoops required to get it out into the world. Everyone can respect, admire, and appreciate that. Plus, once your book is in the world, there's no limit to where it can go or the influence it can have. Nothing can change people's lives like a book. Thousands of stories illustrate that fact. By the way, writing a book can change your life as well. My friend Og Mandino wrote The Greatest Salesman in the World, a little book that happens to be an all-time bestseller. But before he was a writer, Og had a serious alcohol problem. He couldn't be successful at anything. He even thought about ending his life. But fortunately, he wasn't successful at that either. Og was living in New Hampshire, where the winters are about as cold as you can imagine. One day, just to escape the miserable weather, he visited the library. He sat down and found a book on the table in front of him. It was called The Success System That Never Fails. The author was the late W. Clement Stone. Og read it, and then walked all the way to Chicago to get a job with Stone's company, Combined Insurance, now the Aon Corporation. Og's mother had always told him that one day he would be a great writer. He remembered what she said, but did not see how it could ever happen to him. Og started doing some writing, which eventually found its way to the boss and the owner of both Combined Insurance and Success Magazine, Mr. Clem Stone himself. Stone read Og's words and said, "Wow, this is so good. You've got to write for us." Og wound up as editor-in-chief of Success Magazine. He loved to write and was so motivated to use it to help others that he wrote all of his books from 2 to 4 a.m. every morning while his wife, family, and business concerns slept. He liked that time period because there were no phone calls, no family interruptions, or any other distractions. During this time, Og wrote The Greatest Salesman in the World. It was published, and then Richard DeVos, chairman of Amway, read it, loved it, and featured it to all of his multitudes of representatives. The book wound up selling 38 million copies. That's how it happened for a man from New Hampshire who was struggling with a drinking problem. He stopped drinking and changed his drinking addiction to an inspired writing addiction. Brilliant books emerged. How did his life begin to turn around? It was a connection with books. It started when he walked into that library and read Clem Stone's book. It continued when he began writing on his own. It accelerated into high gear when his book was published. Og ultimately got to live his passion, to write, travel, and speak full-time, wowing audiences everywhere. What his mother told him as a young boy was finally coming to fruition. He would someday be a great writer. I have read and reread his inspiring books and encourage you to do the same. I recommend every one of Og's great books to everyone. I predict that you will become a lifelong fan. Some of the bonuses of writing: you become a better reader, a more diligent follower of your favorite authors, a better conversationalist, a more accurate thinker, and more in demand as a wise friend. Will it happen for you as it happened for Ogmandino? Probably not in every detail. But your own miracles will begin to happen, and I want to hear about them. Your commitment to writing a book and your decision to read and use this one are key first steps toward big-time success, both creatively and financially. So congratulations, and let's get started. Part 1. Write a great book. Writing is simple and complicated, hard and easy, painful and pleasurable, natural and unnatural. It's a paradox, like so many other important things in life. There's a lot to say about writing from a philosophical standpoint, but philosophy isn't the focus of this book. I want to give you hands-on information and practical tools. I want to inspire you to find the book that's inside you. I know it's there. And get it into the hands of thousands, even millions of readers worldwide. You have something to say, and it is important that you say it. You know that, and that is why you are listening to this book. The first step is certainty. Not just confidence, not just belief, but the absolute conviction that you have a book inside you that is going to be born. It's the principle on which martial arts like karate are built. When you're punching your hand through a board, you don't focus on striking the wood itself. You concentrate on reaching through the wood to grasp something beyond it, something you want, something you need, something you know is there. You don't have to believe you can write. All you have to do now is believe that I believe you can write, and voila, you really can write. I give you permission and full encouragement to write. I want you to believe in yourself, in your writing ability, and in the phenomenal contribution that you will make to others. Repeat to yourself 101 times a night before you go to sleep, I am a great and inspiring writer and best-selling author. Do this with feeling, belief, and total expectancy. Live in the assumption that your vision, purpose, and hope are fulfilled, and that readers are loving, benefiting from, and automatically sharing your writings. See yourself on the other side of the writing experience, just as a karate master sees his hand pass on to the other side of the board before he makes a move. That's why we will keep saying, live in your imagination, and start with the end in mind. See your bestseller in detail and all that it can mean to you, to your loved ones, and to the world. It costs no more to dream big and have high expectations for yourself. Do this faithfully every night for 1 month. By the month's end, you will have given yourself the auto-suggestion that will make you a decisively great and inspiring writer and best-selling author. Soon, you'll be thanking me in your nightly prayers. When Jack Canfield and I were deep into the creation of Chicken Soup for the Soul, I had a proposed cover design from a graphic artist that I met in Canada. It cost us $1,500. It was worth every penny. We copied the cover and put it on the mirrors in my home and office bathrooms, and in Jack's. As I will relate in future pages in depth, I interviewed 101 of the world's best-selling fiction and non-fiction authors. Not on how to write, but on how they effectively and successfully marketed their bestsellers. From their wisdom, insights, ideas, and how-tos, I wrote what we called a wow of a book business plan, aimed at selling 1.5 million books in 1.5 years. Most importantly, we were visually impregnating the end result of becoming New York Times best-selling authors in our minds as a completed task. Dr. M. Scott Peck, a colleague of Jack's from Harvard, had been at number one for 58 weeks in a row with the superlatively important A Road Less Traveled. We copied his number one book placement, whited out his name, inserted ours, and placed it on top of our new book cover. Thus, every time we, our family, or staff went into the bathroom, we were impressing on our minds the future truth that we planned to express, that we were number one bestsellers, like our colleague and friend, Dr. Peck. We were teased, hassled, and harassed about our bodacious behavior. But the result is worth the criticism. No one remembered their criticism of us after we accomplished what seemed ridiculous and impossible to those who were ignorant of the visualizing is realizing principle. I even made an entire set of audios that are still available, called Visualizing is Realizing. It's a must-do principle that works effectively in all areas of your life. Before you read any further, please take a little time to contemplate what you're about to do. Again, since we're going to be focusing on the tools of writing, I will toss in pertinent philosophical ideas that will help you set your internal GPS and give you the strength to continue, despite the odds. These tools work best when the motivation and the commitment are already solidly in place. Your inner resilience will come from your nightly 101 repetitions of the mantra above. That auto-suggestion will help you commit to write faithfully every day until your work is complete, finished, published, and selling in massive numbers. Once you really have the confidence that defines all successful writers, here's something about which I am certain. The information contained in these pages is the best resource anywhere for building your career as a writer. As a writer myself, I've wanted to publish this book for a long time. It contains everything I've learned about all aspects of writing, from the blank page to the shelves of Barnes & Noble and to Amazon.com worldwide sales. I respect and admire this exciting path of authorship that you have chosen, because it's the same thing I wanted for myself. With all humility, I'm proud to say I love writing, reading, and thinking about the entire process. Even with as much success as I have had as an author, I continue to write more books to this day. I love doing it, and I don't ever want to stop. I believe my best books, audios, videos, podcasts, plays, and movies are yet to be created. I think I am writing better than ever, and am enjoying the experience more than ever. Trust me, you can do it too, starting right now. The first absolute essential: your basic message. What are the absolute essentials for a powerful and successful nonfiction book? As it happens, there are four of them. If you learn nothing else from this book, I urge you to take these four absolute essentials to heart. First, your book must have an interesting and important message to convey. At first, this might seem obvious, but an amazing number of writers fail to clearly define their message. What message do you want to move from your head into the hearts of your readers? For example, is global climate change risking our survival as a species and something we need to deal with right now? Or is global climate change a hyped-up myth? In terms of getting your book organized and written, it doesn't really matter what you think is the truth. What matters is that you are utterly convinced that you know the truth, that you understand it and can prove it, and that you urgently need to share it with your readers. As we all know, former Vice President Al Gore believed his message about global warming. He wrote about it, created a seminar on it, and made An Inconvenient Truth, a movie based on his message. Gore's passion for his message rang so true that he won an Academy Award and a Nobel Peace Prize, and donated over $300 million of his earnings to help end global warming. If you haven't seen this important work, rent it and watch it. Use this as an example to see how far passion, combined with excellent writing, can take you. The second absolute essential: stories about other people. Your life, my life, and everyone's life are stories. Telling better stories means you will have a better life. Stories are more than a luxury, more than just entertainment. Human beings have always relied upon stories to process their lives, their relationships, their past, and their future. Since the beginning of time, every society has provided ways for people to connect through narratives about other people's lives. In ancient times, there were ritual storytellers and dramas. This oral tradition, telling stories around the campfire, was how people passed on culture, history, tradition, and morals. Today, there are films, books, plays, and other media. But the need to find out about other human beings will endure forever. Don't miss any opportunity for storytelling in your book. Whenever you make a major point about your message, illustrate it with a brief anecdote or a fully developed narrative. Whether this requires only one paragraph or several pages, the purpose is to show your readers what you're talking about, not just tell them. In professional speaking, we teach the same process: make a point and tell a story. Stories are heard, remembered, and repeated. The third absolute essential: stories about you. When you read a book, a genuinely intimate connection is formed between you and the writer. Or more accurately, it's the writer's job to see that such a connection develops. By the end of the book, the reader should know you as more than combinations of letters on a page. If you do your job well, you can really come alive for your audience in a mysterious, magical, memorable, and almost mystical way. You will live as a person in the reader's mind. This has to be done carefully, however. It's not just a matter of pasting your bio or resume onto the page. The reader should learn about you over the course of the entire book. A little here and a little there. It all adds up to knowing you through the experiences you share, respecting you, and, most importantly, liking you. Look at the advertisements that major publishers run in book reviews for their new releases. What do you notice about the pictures of the authors in the ads? They look like people you'd want to hang out with. People with whom it would be fun to share a meal or a beer. What you feel when you look at those pictures is exactly what you want your readers to feel as they read your book. The fourth absolute essential: action steps for the reader. The word takeaway should be in the forefront of every writer's mind. What do you want your readers to take with them and use in their everyday lives after they've read your book? You want to cause instant behavioral change. One great example is from my friend Jeff Hoffman, serial entrepreneur, author, filmmaker, Grammy Award winner, software engineer, billionaire, best known as creator of Priceline and the kiosks that enable you to print your ticket for your airline seat. Jeff is a master storyteller and a relatable thinker. He inspires everyone to believe that they can create a fortune and have a fulfilling and enjoyable life doing it. Please watch him online. Jeff teaches what he calls the golden purpose. It is the intersection of 1, the work you are best at, 2, the thing you love, and 3, what the world values enough to pay you substantially to do. With regard to number 1, Jeff advises you to ask 10 friends to write out and submit to you what each of them thinks you are best at doing. He says you will be pleasantly surprised and delighted. Asking 10 friends is a specific takeaway that can instantly change your behavior. If you do your job correctly, readers will gain a lot more than some abstract ideas. They'll take away information you've provided, things that they can use in their own lives, steps they can take right now to put what they've learned into action. This is a critically important component of a book, and one that's often overlooked by writers. The day is long gone when people read books simply for entertainment. Today, people buy nonfiction books the same way they buy over-the-counter medicines. They want results. They're willing to work for those results, provided they're told, by you, exactly what that work should involve. Providing action steps for your readers to follow are the 4th and final absolute essential for your book. Put that step into action. The one question every writer must answer. You've got a story to tell. You've got valuable information to share. I hope what you've listened to so far has assured you of that. I hope you also understand that many people, including you, will benefit when you tell your story and share your wisdom. So what's the first step? That's a really important question, because the first step in writing a book is really the most challenging. Again and again, I've seen new writers sitting at a keyboard with a blank screen in front of them. Or if the screen isn't totally blank, it's a battleground of revisions and corrections that add up to nothing much. The cause of all this, of course, is the writer's belief that the first sentence has to be perfect, and not just the first sentence, but the book as a whole. After all, this isn't just a letter to grandma we're writing here. This is a book that's going to be sold in stores, just like the complete works of Shakespeare, not to mention the Bible. We're going to ask people to pay good money for this, so it has to be great. It has to be clean and shiny and fussed over, just like the 7th grade term papers you nervously wrote and carefully stored in a transparent plastic binder. Your book has to be perfect, doesn't it? No, it doesn't. In fact, you shouldn't even try for perfection. Because if you do, you're much more likely to get nothing at all. With this in mind, I'm now going to reveal the one question you should always be asking yourself in order to avoid perfectionism and get what's in your mind onto the paper in front of you. The question is, what are you trying to say? To show you exactly why that seemingly innocent question is so powerful and important, let me dramatize it for you. Picture sitting at your computer, contemplating what you're going to write. Or imagine you're revising, for the 5th time, what you've written so far. At that moment, your best friend calls, and before long, the conversation turns to the trouble you're having with your book. "I just can't seem to get it right," you explain. "I know what I want to get on the page, but I can't find the correct words for saying it." At that point, your friend asks a logical question. What are you trying to say? So you explain what you're trying to say. And then, when the phone conversation is over, you're back to trying to say it. But what if, when your friend asked, "What are you trying to say?" you had just gone ahead and written down your answer? What if you just stopped trying and started writing? It's amazing how simple this is. I've seen it work again and again with writers who seem to be hopelessly bogged down. Ask yourself, or imagine that a close friend is asking, What are you trying to say? Then immediately write down your answer, word for word. Don't think about it. Just write it. And then use your momentum to continue writing. If you get stuck, ask the magic question again. If you're not entirely happy with what's on the page, you can go back over it later. Or that's what editors are for. But now you're moving ahead. On the first pass, you may not get everything exactly right, but you will get it written. You have unique knowledge to communicate. You have information that no one else has. So don't feel you have to morph into someone else. Not Mark Victor Hansen, not even William Shakespeare, when you actually start typing. You can avoid that temptation by continually asking, "What am I trying to say?" and simply writing your answer to that question on the page. It should be on the page exactly as you express it in your own mind, rather than the way you think anyone else would say it. Get used to it. Writing is a challenging, complicated activity, and virtually all activities of this kind are hard the first time you try them. Writing can be painful, mentally, emotionally, and even physically. It can also be hugely rewarding and exhilarating. But you've got to get used to it. You've got to get over that panic and stop feeling like it's the first day of school or your first date. Even for the most successful writers, filling up the page isn't always easy. Joyce Carol Oates is one of the most acclaimed fiction writers of our time. She's written approximately 60 novels, plus short stories, poetry, nonfiction, and even children's books. In a National Book Award interview, Oates said, "Each day is like an enormous rock that I'm trying to push up this hill. I get it up a fair distance, it rolls back a little bit, and I keep pushing it, hoping I'll get it to the top of the hill and that it will go on its own momentum. But I've never given up. I've always kept going. I don't feel that I could afford to give up. Yet I am not conscious of working especially hard, or of working at all. Writing and teaching have always been, for me, so richly rewarding that I don't think of them as work in the usual sense of the word." Simply put, Oates is used to the process of putting words on the page. It may not always be easy, but it's natural. That's the way it is for professional writers. It can't be something you do only once in a while. You've got to write as much as you can. You've got to feel at home with it. Writing has to become a natural action that you do all the time. This is an area where I feel I've made some real progress. I try to write for at least a couple of hours every day. Airplanes are an especially good writing workplace. The airplane is my office in the sky. Talking is a big part of my life, but I don't talk on planes. I just keep working, and people leave me alone. I'm not there to impress anyone. I'm trying to get from one place to another, both in the sky and on the page. Early in my career as a speaker and writer, I traveled a bit with America's most beloved minister, Dr. Norman Vincent Peale, author of the must-read book that has sold 25 million copies, The Power of Positive Thinking. This was before computers. Dr. Peale carried two big briefcases filled with folders for his 52 future church sermons at New York's prestigious Marble Collegiate Church and for books and pamphlets that he intended to write. Dr. Peale told me that once he titled the 52 sermon files, which he did before the start of each year started, the information seemed to magically and mystically flow to and through him. It is the law of attraction in action. He had the attractor factor working, and so can you. People would say things innocently, and he would record what they told him. Dr. Peel stashed their stories in his files for future use. He created a mindset that would attract stories, anecdotes, jokes, humor, experiences, and memories that would make his sermons awe-inspiring, dynamic, and wonderfully insightful. While living in New York, I went to Dr. Peel's church faithfully every Sunday and met the who's who of the world. Mrs. Peel took a liking to me. She frequently invited me to sit with her and the corporate, business, and world leaders who were attending, in awe of Dr. Peel's relief.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.